In passive immediate sensorial attention, the stimulus is a sense impression, either very intense, voluminous, or sudden, in which case it makes no difference what its nature may be, whether sight, sound, smell, blow, or inner pain, or else it is an instinctive stimulus, a perception which, by reason of its nature rather than its mere force, appeals to some one of our normal congenital impulses and has a directly exciting quality. In the chapter 0 on instinct, we shall see how these stimuli differ from one animal to another, and what most of them are in man: strange things, moving things, wild animals, bright things, pretty things, metallic things, words, blows, blood, etc., etc., etc. Sensitiveness to immediately exciting sensorial stimuli characterizes the attention of childhood and youth. In mature age, we have generally selected those stimuli which are connected with one or more so-called permanent interests, and our attention has grown irresponsive to the rest. But childhood is characterized by great active energy, and has few organized interests by which to meet new impressions and decide whether they are worthy of notice or not, and the consequence is that extreme mobility of the attention with which we are all familiar in children, and which makes their first lessons such rough affairs. Any strong sensation whatever produces accommodation of the organs which perceive it, and absolute oblivion, for the time being, of the task in hand. This reflex and passive character of the attention which, as a French writer says, makes the child seem to belong less to himself than to every object which happens to catch his notice, is the first thing which the teacher must overcome. It never is overcome in some people, whose work, to the end of life, gets done in the interstices of their mind wandering. The passive sensorial attention is derived when the impression, without being either strong or of an instinctively exciting nature, is connected by previous experience and education with things that are so. These things may be called the motives of the attention. The impression draws an interest from them, or perhaps it even fuses into a single complex object with them. The result is that it is brought into the focus of the mind. A faint tap per se is not an interesting sound. It may well escape being discriminated from the general rumor of the world. But when it is a signal, as that of a lover on the windowpane, it will hardly go unperceived. Herbart writes, "How a bit of bad grammar wounds the ear of the purist! How a false note hurts the musician! Or an offense against good manners the man of the world! How rapid is progress in a science when its first principles have been so well impressed upon us that we reproduce them mentally with perfect distinctness and ease. How slow and uncertain, on the other hand, is our learning of the principles themselves, when familiarity with the still more elementary percepts connected with the subject has not given us an adequate predisposition. Apperceptive attention may be plainly observed in very small children when, hearing the speech of their elders, as yet unintelligible to them, they suddenly catch a single known word here and there, and repeat it to themselves. Yes. Even in the dog who looks round at us when we speak of him and pronounce his name. Not far removed is the talent which mind-wandering schoolboys display during the hours of instruction, of noticing every moment in which the teacher tells a story. I remember classes in which, instruction being uninteresting, and discipline relaxed, a buzzing murmur was always to be heard, which invariably stopped for as long a time as an anecdote lasted. How could the boys, since they seemed to hear nothing, notice when the anecdote began? Doubtless most of them always heard something of the teacher's talk. But most of it had no connection with their previous knowledge and occupations. And therefore the separate words no sooner entered their consciousness than they fell out of it again. But, on the other hand, no sooner did the words awaken old thoughts, forming strongly connected series with which the new impression easily combined, then out of new and old together a total interest resulted which drove the vagrant ideas below the threshold of consciousness, and brought for a while settled attention into their place. Passive intellectual attention is immediate when we follow in thought a train of images exciting or interesting per se, derived, when the images are interesting only as means to a remote end, or merely because they are associated with something which makes them dear. Owing to the way in which immense numbers of real things become integrated into single objects of thought for us, there is no clear line to be drawn between immediate and derived attention of an intellectual sort. When absorbed in intellectual attention, we may become so inattentive to outer things as to be absent-minded, abstracted, or distrait. All reverie or concentrated meditation is apt to throw us into this state. Archimedes, it is well known, was so absorbed in geometrical meditation that he was first aware of the storming of Syracuse by his own death wound, and his exclamation on the entrance of the Roman soldiers was, Nolli turbcirculos meos. In like manner Joseph Scaliger, the most learned of men, when a Protestant student in Paris, was so engrossed in the study of Homer that he became aware of the massacre of St. Bartholomew, and of his own escape, only on the day subsequent to the catastrophe. The philosopher Carneades was habitually liable to fits of meditation so profound that, to prevent him sinking from inanition, his maid found it necessary to feed him like a child. And it is reported of Newton that, while engaged in his mathematical researches, he sometimes forgot to dine. Cardan, one of the most illustrious of philosophers and mathematicians, was once, upon a journey, so lost in thought that he forgot both his way and the object of his journey. To the questions of his driver whether he should proceed, he made no answer, and when he came to himself at nightfall, he was surprised to find the carriage at a standstill, and directly under a gallows. The mathematician Vieta was sometimes so buried in meditation that for hours he bore more resemblance to a dead person than to a living, and was then wholly unconscious of everything going on around him. On the day of his marriage the great Budaeus forgot everything in his philological speculations, and he was only awakened to the affairs of the external world by a tardy embassy from the marriage party, who found him absorbed in the composition of his commentarii. The absorption may be so deep as not only to banish ordinary sensations, but even the severest pain. Pascal, Wesley, Robert Hall, are said to have had this capacity. Dr. Carpenter says of himself that, he has frequently begun a lecture whilst suffering neuralgic pain so severe as to make him apprehend that he would find it impossible to proceed. Yet no sooner has he by a determined effort fairly launched himself into the stream of thought, than he has found himself continuously borne along without the least distraction, until the end has come. And the attention has been released. When the pain has recurred with a force that has overmastered all resistance, making him wonder how he could have ever ceased to feel it. Dr. Carpenter speaks of launching himself by a determined effort. This effort characterizes what we called active or voluntary attention. It is a feeling which everyone knows, but which most people would call quite indescribable. We get it in the sensorial sphere whenever we seek to catch an impression of extreme faintness, be it of sight, hearing, taste, smell, or touch. We get it whenever we seek to discriminate a sensation merged in a mass of others that are similar. We get it whenever we resist the attractions of more potent stimuli and keep our mind occupied with some object that is naturally unimpressive. We get it in the intellectual sphere under exactly similar conditions, as when we strive to sharpen and make distinct an idea which we but vaguely seem to have, or painfully discriminate a shade of meaning from its similars, or resolutely hold fast to a thought so discordant with our impulses that, if left unaided, it would quickly yield place to images of an exciting and impassioned kind. All forms of attentive effort would be exercised at once by one whom we might suppose at a dinner party resolutely to listen to a neighbor giving him insipid and unwelcome advice in a low voice, whilst all around the guests were loudly laughing and talking about exciting and interesting things. There is no such thing as voluntary attention sustained for more than a few seconds at a time. What is called sustained voluntary attention is a repetition of successive efforts which bring back the topic to the mind. The topic once brought back, if a congenial one, develops, and if its development is interesting it engages the attention passively for a time. Dr. Carpenter, a moment back, described the stream of thought, once entered, as bearing him along. This passive interest may be short or long. As soon as it flags, the attention is diverted by some irrelevant thing, and then a voluntary effort may bring it back to the topic again, and so on, under favorable conditions, for hours together. During all this time, however, note that it is not an identical object in the psychological sense, page 275, but a succession of mutually related objects forming an identical topic only, upon which the attention is fixed. No one can possibly attend continuously to an object that does not change. Now there are always some objects that for the time being will not develop. They simply go out, and to keep the mind upon anything related to them requires such incessantly renewed effort that the most resolute will ere long gives out and lets its thoughts follow the more stimulating solicitations after it has withstood them for what length of time it can. There are topics known to every man from which he shies like a frightened horse, and which to get a glimpse of is to shun. Such are his ebbing assets to the spendthrift in full career. But why single out the spendthrift when to every man actuated by passion the thought of interests which negate the passion can hardly for more than a fleeting instant stay before the mind? It is like memento mori in the heyday of the pride of life. Nature rises at such suggestions, and excludes them from the view. How long, O healthy reader, can you now continue thinking of your tomb? In milder instances the difficulty is as great, especially when the brain is fagged. One snatches at any and every passing pretext, no matter how trivial or external, to escape from the odiousness of the matter in hand. I know a person, for example, who will poke the fire, set chairs straight, pick dust specks from the floor, arrange his table, snatch up the newspaper, take down any book which catches his eye, trim his nails, waste the morning. Anyhow, in short, and all without premeditation, simply because the only thing he ought to attend to is the preparation of a noonday lesson in formal logic which he detests. Anything but that. Once more, the object must change. When it is one of sight, it will actually become invisible, when of hearing, inaudible, if we attend to it too unmovingly. Helmholtz, who has put his sensorial attention to the severest tests, by using his eyes on objects which in common life are expressly overlooked, makes some interesting remarks on this point in his chapter 0 on retinal rivalry. The phenomenon called by that name is this, that if we look with each eye upon a different picture, as in the annex stereoscopic slide, sometimes one picture, sometimes the other, or parts of both, will come to consciousness, but hardly ever both combined. Helmholtz now says, I find that I am able to attend voluntarily, now to one and now to the other system of lines, and that then this system remains visible alone for a certain time, whilst the other completely vanishes. This happens, for example, whenever I try to count the lines first of one and then of the other system. But it is extremely hard to chain the attention down to one of the systems for long, unless we associate with our looking some distinct purpose which keeps the activity of the attention perpetually renewed. Such a one is counting the lines, comparing their intervals, or the like. An equilibrium of the attention, persistent for any length of time, is under no circumstances attainable. The natural tendency of attention when left to itself is to wander to ever new things, and so soon as the interest of its object is over, so soon as nothing new is to be noticed there, it passes, in spite of our will, to something else. If we wish to keep it upon one and the same object, we must seek constantly to find out something new about the latter, especially if other powerful impressions are attracting us away. And again criticizing an author who had treated of attention as an activity absolutely subject to the conscious will, Helmholtz writes, this is only restrictedly true. We move our eyes by our will, but one without training cannot so easily execute the intention of making them converge. At any moment, however, he can execute that of looking at a near object, in which act convergence is involved. Now just as little can we carry out our purpose to keep our attention steadily fixed upon a certain object, when our interest in the object is exhausted, and the purpose is inwardly formulated in this abstract way. But we can set ourselves new questions about the object, so that a new interest in it arises, and then the attention will remain riveted. The relation of attention to will is, then, less one of immediate than of mediate control. These words of Helmholtz are of fundamental importance. And if true of sensorial attention, how much more true are they of the intellectual variety? The conditio sine qua non of sustained attention to a given topic of thought is that we should roll it over and over incessantly and consider different aspects and relations of it in turn. Only in pathological states will a fixed and ever monotonously recurring idea possess the mind. And now we can see why it is that what is called sustained attention is the easier, the richer in acquisitions and the fresher and more original the mind. In such minds, subjects bud and sprout and grow. At every moment, they please by a new consequence and rivet the attention afresh. But an intellect unfurnished with materials, stagnant, unoriginal, will hardly be likely to consider any subject long. A glance exhausts its possibilities of interest. Geniuses are commonly believed to excel other men in their power of sustained attention. In most of them, it is to be feared, the so-called power is of the passive sort. Their ideas coruscate, Every subject branches infinitely before their fertile minds, and so for hours they may be rapt. But it is their genius making them attentive, not their attention making geniuses of them. And, when we come down to the root of the matter, we see that they differ from ordinary men less in the character of their attention than in the nature of the objects upon which it is successively bestowed. In the genius, these form a concatenated series, suggesting each other mutually by some rational law. Therefore, we call the attention sustained and the topic of meditation for hours the same. In the common man, the series is for the most part incoherent, the objects have no rational bond, and we call the attention wandering and unfixed. It is probable that genius tends actually to prevent a man from acquiring habits of voluntary attention, and that moderate intellectual endowments are the soil in which we may best expect, here as elsewhere, the virtues of the will, strictly so called, to thrive. But, whether the attention come by grace of genius or by dint of will, the longer one does attend to a topic, the more mastery of it one has. And the faculty of voluntarily bringing back a wandering attention, over and over again, is the very root of judgment, character, and will. No one is compass sway if he have it not. An education which should improve this faculty would be the education par excellence. But it is easier to define this ideal than to give practical directions for bringing it about. The only general pedagogic maxim bearing on attention is that the more interest the child has in advance in the subject, the better he will attend. Induct him therefore in such a way as to knit each new thing on to some acquisition already there, and if possible awaken curiosity, so that the new thing shall seem to come as an answer, or part of an answer, to a question pre-existing in his mind. At present, having described the varieties, let us turn to the effects of attention. Its remote effects are too incalculable to be recorded. The practical and theoretical life of whole species, as well as of individual beings, results from the selection which the habitual direction of their attention involves. In chapters 14 and 15, some of these consequences will come to light. Suffice it meanwhile that each of us literally chooses, by his ways of attending to things, what sort of a universe he shall appear to himself to inhabit. The immediate effects of attention are to make us a. perceive, b. conceive, c. distinguish, d. remember better than otherwise we could both more successive things and each thing more clearly. It also e. shortens reaction time. A and B. Most people would say that a sensation attended to becomes stronger than it otherwise would be. This point is, however, not quite plain, and has occasioned some discussion. From the strength or intensity of a sensation must be distinguished its clearness, and to increase this is, for some psychologists, the utmost that attention can do. When the facts are surveyed, however, it must be admitted that to some extent the relative intensity of two sensations may be changed when one of them is attended to and the other not. Every artist knows how he can make a scene before his eyes appear warmer or colder in color, according to the way he sets his attention. If for warm, he soon begins to see the red color start out of everything, if for cold, the blue. Similarly, in listening for certain notes in a chord, or overtones in a musical sound, the one we attend to sounds probably a little more loud as well as more emphatic than it did before. When we mentally break a series of monotonous strokes into a rhythm, by accentuating every second or third one, etc., the stroke on which the stress of attention is laid seems to become stronger as well as more emphatic. The increased visibility of optical afterimages and of double images, which close attention brings about, can hardly be interpreted otherwise than as a real strengthening of the retinal sensations themselves. And this view is rendered particularly probable by the fact that an imagined visual object may, if attention be concentrated upon it long enough, acquire before the mind's eye almost the brilliancy of reality, and, in the case of certain exceptionally gifted observers, leave a negative afterimage of itself when it passes away. See Chapter 18. Confident expectation of a certain intensity or quality of impression will often make us sensibly see or hear it in an object which really falls far short of it. In face of such facts, it is rash to say that attention cannot make a sense impression more intense. But, on the other hand, the intensification which may be brought about seems never to lead the judgment astray. As we rightly perceive and name the same color under various lights, the same sound at various distances, so we seem to make an analogous sort of allowance for the varying amounts of attention with which objects are viewed, and whatever changes of feeling the attention may bring, we charge, as it were, to the attention's account, and still perceive and conceive the object as the same. A gray paper appears to us no lighter, the pendulum beat of a clock no louder, no matter how much we increase the strain of our attention upon them. No one, by doing this, can make the gray paper look white, or the stroke of the pendulum sound like the blow of a strong hammer. Everyone, on the contrary, feels the increase as that of his own conscious activity turned upon the thing. Were it otherwise, we should not be able to note intensities by attending to them. Weak impressions would, as Stump says, become stronger by the very fact of being observed. I should not be able to observe faint sounds at all, but only such as appeared to me of maximal strength, or at least of a strength that increased with the amount of my observation. In reality, however, I can, with steadily increasing attention, follow a diminuendo perfectly well. The subject is one which would well repay exact experiment, if methods could be devised. Meanwhile, there is no question whatever that attention augments the clearness of all that we perceive or conceive by its aid. But what is meant by clearness here? See, clearness, so far as attention produces it, means distinction from other things and internal analysis or subdivision. These are essentially products of intellectual discrimination, involving comparison, memory, and perception of various relations. The attention, per se, does not distinguish and analyze and relate. The most we can say is that it is a condition of our doing so. And as these processes are to be described later, the clearness they produce had better not be farther discussed here. The important point to notice here is that it is not attention's immediate fruit. D. Whatever future conclusion we may reach as to this, we cannot deny that an object once attended to will remain in the memory, whilst one inattentively allowed to pass will leave no traces behind. Already in Chapter 6, see pages 163 FF, we discussed whether certain states of mind were unconscious, or whether they were not rather states to which no attention had been paid, and of whose passage recollection could afterwards find no vestiges. Dugald Stewart says, the connection between attention and memory has been remarked by many authors. He quotes Quintilian, Locke, and Helvetius, and goes on at great length to explain the phenomena of secondary automatism, see above, page 114 FF, by the presence of a mental action grown so inattentive as to preserve no memory of itself. In our chapter 0 on memory, later on, the point will come up again. E. Under this head, the shortening of reaction time, there is a good deal to be said of attention's effects. Since Wundt has probably worked over the subject more thoroughly than any other investigator and made it peculiarly his own, what follows had better, as far as possible, be in his words. The reader will remember the method and results of experimentation on reaction time, as given in Chapter 3. The facts I proceed to quote may also be taken as a supplement to that chapter. Wundt writes, when we wait with strained attention for a stimulus, it will often happen that instead of registering the stimulus, we react upon some entirely different impression, and this not through confounding the one with the other. On the contrary, we are perfectly well aware at the moment of making the movement that we respond to the wrong stimulus. Sometimes even, though not so often, the latter may be another kind of sensation altogether. One may, for example, in experimenting with sound, register a flash of light, produced either by accident or design. We cannot well explain these results otherwise than by assuming that the strain of the attention towards the impression we expect coexists with a preparatory innervation of the motor center for the reaction, which innervation the slightest shock then suffices to turn into an actual discharge. This shock may be given by any chance impression, even by one to which we never intended to respond. When the preparatory innervation has once reached this pitch of intensity, the time that intervenes between the stimulus and the contraction of the muscles which react may become vanishingly small. The perception of an impression is facilitated when the impression is preceded by a warning which announces beforehand that it is about to occur. This case is realized whenever several stimuli follow each other at equal intervals, when, e.g., we note pendulum movements by the eye, or pendulum strokes by the ear. Each single stroke forms here the signal for the next, which is thus met by a fully prepared attention. The same thing happens when the stimulus to be perceived is preceded, at a certain interval, by a single warning. The time is always notably shortened. I have made comparative observations on reaction time with and without a warning signal. The impression to be reacted on was the sound made by the dropping of a ball on the board of the drop apparatus. In a first series, no warning preceded the stroke of the ball. In the second, the noise made by the apparatus in liberating the ball served as a signal. In a long series of experiments, the interval between warning and stimulus remaining the same, the reaction time grows less and less, and it is possible occasionally to reduce it to a vanishing quantity, a few thousandths of a second, to zero, or even to a negative value. The only ground that we can assign for this phenomenon is the preparation, Vorbereitungsspannung, of the attention. It is easy to understand that the reaction time should be shortened by this means, but that it should sometimes sink to zero and even assume negative values may appear surprising. Nevertheless, this latter case is also explained by what happens in the simple reaction time experiments, just referred to, in which, when the strain of the attention has reached its climax, the movement we stand ready to execute escapes from the control of on will, and we register a wrong signal. In these other experiments, in which a warning foretells the moment of the stimulus, it is also plain that attention accommodates itself so exactly to the latter's reception that no sooner is it objectively given than it is fully apperceived, and with the apperception the motor discharge coincides. Usually, when the impression is fully anticipated, attention prepares the motor center so completely for both stimulus and reaction that the only time lost is that of the physiological conduction downwards. But even this interval may disappear, i.e. the stimulus and reaction may become objectively contemporaneous, or more remarkable still, the reaction may be discharged before the stimulus has actually occurred. Wundt, as we saw some pages back, page 411, explains this by the effort of the mind so to react that we may feel our own movement and the signal which prompts it, both at the same instant. As the execution of the movement must precede our feeling of it, so it must also precede the stimulus, if that and our movement are to be felt at once. The peculiar theoretic interest of these experiments lies in their showing expectant attention and sensation to be continuous or identical processes, since they may have identical motor effects. Although other exceptional observations show them likewise to be continuous subjectively, Wundt's experiments do not, he seems never, at the moment of reacting prematurely, to have been misled into the belief that the real stimulus was there. As concentrated attention accelerates perception, so, conversely, perception of a stimulus is retarded by anything which either baffles or distracts the attention with which we await it. If, example, we make reactions on a sound in such a way that weak and strong stimuli irregularly alternate so that the observer can never expect to determine its strength with any certainty, the reaction time for all the various signals is increased, and so is the average error. Still greater is the increase of the time when, unexpectedly into a series of strong impressions, a weak one is interpolated, or vice versa. In this way I have seen the time of reaction upon a sound so weak as to be barely perceived rise to 0.4 inch or 0.5, and for a strong sound to 0.25. It is also matter of general experience that a stimulus expected in a general way, but for whose intensity attention cannot be adapted in advance, demands a longer reaction time. In such cases, the reason for the difference can only lie in the fact that wherever a preparation of the attention is impossible, the time of both perception and volition is prolonged. Perhaps also the conspicuously large reaction times which are got with stimuli so faint as to be just perceptible may be explained by the attention tending always to adapt itself for something more than this minimal amount of stimulus, so that a state ensues similar to that in the case of unexpected stimuli. Still more than by previously unknown stimuli is the reaction time prolonged by wholly unexpected impressions. This is sometimes accidentally brought about when the observer's attention, instead of being concentrated on the coming signal, is dispersed. It can be realized purposely by suddenly thrusting into a long series of equidistant stimuli a much shorter interval which the observer does not expect. The mental effect here is like that of being startled; often the startling is outwardly visible. The time of reaction may then easily be lengthened to 1/4 of a second with strong signals, or with weak ones to a half second. Slighter, but still very noticeable, is the retardation when the experiment is so arranged that the observer, ignorant whether the stimulus is to be an impression of light, sound, or touch, cannot keep his attention turned to any particular sense organ in advance. One notices then at the same time a peculiar unrest, as the feeling of strain which accompanies the attention keeps vacillating between the several senses. Complications of another sort arise when what is registered is an impression anticipated both in point of quality and strength, but accompanied by other stimuli which make the concentration of the attention difficult. The reaction time is here always more or less prolonged. The simplest case of the sort is where a momentary impression is registered in the midst of another, and continuous, sensorial stimulation of considerable strength. The continuous stimulus may belong to the same sense as the stimulus to be reacted on, or to another. When it is of the same sense, the retardation it causes may be partly due to the distraction of the attention by it, but partly also to the fact that the stimulus to be reacted on stands out less strongly than if alone, and practically becomes a less intense sensation. But other factors in reality are present, for we find the reaction time more prolonged by the concomitant stimulation when the stimulus is weak than when it is strong. I made experiments in which the principal impression, or signal for reaction, was a bell stroke whose strength could be graduated by a spring against the hammer with a movable counterpoise. Each set of observations comprise two series, in one of which the bell stroke was registered in the ordinary way, whilst in the other a toothed wheel belonging to the chronometric apparatus made during the entire experiment a steady noise against a metal spring. In one half of the latter series, A, the bell stroke was only moderately strong, so that the accompanying noise diminished it considerably, without, however, making it indistinguishable. In the other half, B, the bell sound was so loud as to be heard with perfect distinctness above the noise. Since, in these experiments, the sound B even with noise made a considerably stronger impression than the sound A without, we must see in the figures a direct influence of the disturbing noise on the process of reaction. This influence is freed from mixture with other factors when the momentary stimulus and the concomitant disturbance appeal to different senses. I chose, to test this, sight and hearing. The momentary signal was an induction spark leaping from one platinum point to another against a dark background. The steady stimulation was the noise above described. When one reflects that in the experiments with one and the same cc, the relative intensity of the signal is always depressed the amount O retardation in these last observations makes it probable that the disturbing influence upon attention is greater when the stimuli are disparate than when they belong to the same sense. One does not, in fact, find it particularly hard to register immediately, when the bell rings in the midst of the noise, but when the spark is the signal one has a feeling of being coerced, as one turns away from the noise towards it. This fact is immediately connected with other properties of our attention. The effort of the latter is accompanied by various corporeal sensations, according to the sense which is engaged. The innervation which exists during the effort of attention is therefore probably a different one for each sense organ. Still more interesting reaction time observations have been made by Münsterberg. The reader will recollect the fact noted in Chapter 3 that reaction time is shorter when one concentrates his attention on the expected movement than when one concentrates it on the expected signal. Herr Münsterberg found that this is equally the case when the reaction is no simple reflex, but can take place only after an intellectual operation. In a series of experiments, the five fingers were used to react with, and the reactor had to use a different finger according as the signal was of one sort or another. Thus when a word in the nominative case was called out he used the thumb, for the dative he used another finger, similarly adjectives, substantives, pronouns, numerals, etc., or, again, towns, rivers, beasts, plants, elements, or poets, musicians, philosophers, etc., were coordinated each with its finger, so that when a word belonging to either of these classes was mentioned, a particular finger and no other had to perform the reaction. In a second series of experiments the reaction consisted in the utterance of a word in answer to a question, such as, name an edible fish, etc., or, name the first drama of Schiller, etc., or, which is greater, Hume or Kant, etc., or, first naming apples and cherries, and several other fruits, which do you prefer, apples or cherries, etc., or, which is Goethe's finest drama, etc., or, which letter comes the later in the alphabet, the letter L or the first letter of the most beautiful tree, etc., or, which is less, 15 or 20, minus 8, etc., etc., etc. Even in this series of reactions, the time was much quicker. The reactor turned his attention in advance towards the answer than when he turned it towards the question. The shorter reaction time was seldom more than 1/5 of a second, the longer, from 4 to 8 times as long. To understand such results, one must bear in mind that in these experiments the reactor always knew in advance in a general way the kind of question which he was to receive, and consequently the sphere within which his possible answer lay. Both are sensations of an afferent sort. But in intellectual attention, as we have already seen, page 300, similar feelings of activity occur. Fechner was the first, I believe, to analyze these feelings and discriminate them from the stronger ones just named. He writes, "When we transfer the attention from objects of one sense to those of another, we have an indescribable feeling, though at the same time one perfectly determinate, and reproducible at pleasure, of altered direction or differently localized tension, spannung. We feel a strain forward in the eyes, one directed sidewise in the ears, increasing with the degree of our attention, and changing according as we look at an object carefully, or listen to something attentively, and we speak accordingly of straining the attention. The difference is most plainly felt when the attention oscillates rapidly between eye and ear, and the feeling localizes itself with most decided difference in regard to the various sense organs, according as we wish to discriminate a thing delicately by touch, taste, or smell. But now I have, when I try to vividly recall a picture of memory or fancy, a feeling perfectly analogous to that which I experience when I seek to apprehend a thing keenly by eye or ear, and this analogous feeling is very differently localized. While in sharpest possible attention to real objects, as well as to after images, the strain is plainly forwards. And when the attention changes from one sense to another only alters its direction between the several external sense organs, leaving the rest of the head free from strain, the case is different in memory or fancy, for here the feeling withdraws entirely from the external sense organs, and seems rather to take refuge in that part of the head which the brain fills. If I wish, for example, to recall a place or person, it will arise before me with vividness, not according as I strain my attention forwards, but rather in proportion as I, so to speak, retract it backwards. In myself the backward retraction, which is felt during attention to ideas of memory, etc., seems to be principally constituted by the feeling of an actual rolling outwards and upwards of the eyeballs, such as occurs in sleep, and is the exact opposite of their behavior when we look at a physical thing. I have already spoken of this feeling on page 300. The reader who doubts the presence of these organic feelings is requested to read the whole of that passage again. It has been said, however, that we may attend to an object on the periphery of the visual field and yet not accommodate the eye for it. Teachers thus notice the acts of children in the schoolroom at whom they appear not to be looking. Women in general train their peripheral visual attention more than men. This would be an objection to the invariable and universal presence of movements of adjustment as ingredients of the attentive process. Usually, as is well known, no object lying in the marginal portions of the field of vision can catch our attention without at the same time catching our eye, that is, fatally provoking such movements of rotation and accommodation as will focus its image on the fovea, or point of greatest sensibility. Practice, however, enables us, with effort, to attend to a marginal object whilst keeping the eyes immovable. The object under these circumstances never becomes perfectly distinct. The place of its image on the retina makes distinctness impossible, but, as anyone can satisfy himself by trying, we become more vividly conscious of it than we were before the effort was made. Helmholtz states the fact so strikingly that I will quote his observation in full. He was trying to combine in a single solid percept pairs of stereoscopic pictures illuminated instantaneously by the electric spark. The pictures were in a dark box which the spark from time to time lighted up, and, to keep the eyes from wandering between whiles, a pinhole was pricked through the middle of each picture, through which the light of the room came, so that each eye had presented to it during the dark intervals a single bright point. With parallel optical axes the points combined into a single image, and the slightest movement of the eyeballs was betrayed by this image at once becoming double. Helmholtz now found that simple linear figures could, when the eyes were thus kept immovable, be perceived as solids at a single flash of the spark. But when the figures were complicated photographs, many successive flashes were required to grasp their totality. Now it is interesting, he says, to find that, although we keep steadily fixating the pinholes and never allow their combined image to break into two, we can, nevertheless, before the spark comes, keep our attention voluntarily turned to any particular portion we please of the dark field, so as then, when the spark comes, to receive an impression only from such parts of the picture as lie in this region. In this respect, then, our attention is quite independent of the position and accommodation of the eyes, and of any known alteration in these organs, and free to direct itself by a conscious and voluntary effort upon any selected portion of a dark and undifferenced field of view. This is one of the most important observations for a future theory of attention. Herring, however, adds the following detail: whilst attending to the marginal object we must always, he says, attend at the same time to the object directly fixated. If even for a single instant we let the latter slip out of our mind, our eye moves towards the former, as may be easily recognized by the afterimages produced, or by the muscular sounds heard. The case is then less properly to be called one of translocation, than one of unusually wide dispersion, of the attention, in which dispersion the largest share still falls upon the thing directly looked at, and consequently directly accommodated for. Accommodation exists here, then, as it does elsewhere, and without it we should lose a part of our sense of attentive activity. In fact, the strain of that activity, which is remarkably great in the experiment, is due in part to unusually strong contractions of the muscles needed to keep the eyeballs still, which produce unwanted feelings of pressure in those organs. 2. But if the peripheral part of the picture in this experiment be not physically accommodated for, what is meant by its sharing our attention? What happens when we distribute or disperse the latter upon a thing for which we remain unwilling to adjust? This leads us to that second feature in the process, the ideational preparation, of which we spoke. The effort to attend to the marginal region of the picture consists in nothing more nor less than the effort to form as clear an idea as is possible of what is there portrayed. The idea is to come to the help of the sensation and make it more distinct. It comes with effort, and such a mode of coming is the remaining part of what we know as our attention's strain under the circumstances. Let us show how universally present in our acts of attention this reinforcing imagination, this inward reproduction, this anticipatory thinking of the thing we attend to, is. It must as a matter of course be present when the attention is of the intellectual variety, for the thing attended to then is nothing but an idea, an inward reproduction or conception. If then we prove ideal construction of the object to be present in sensorial attention, it will be present everywhere. When, however, sensorial attention is at its height, it is impossible to tell how much of the percept comes from without and how much from within, but if we find that the preparation we make for it always partly consists of the creation of an imaginary duplicate of the object in the mind, which shall stand ready to receive the outward impression as if in a matrix, that will be quite enough to establish the point in dispute. In Wundt's and Exner's experiments quoted above, the lying in wait for the impressions, and the preparation to react, consist of nothing but the anticipatory imagination of what the impressions or the reactions are to be. Where the stimulus is unknown and the reaction undetermined, time is lost, because no stable image can under such circumstances be formed in advance. But where both nature and time of signal and reaction are foretold, so completely does the expectant attention consist in premonitory imagination that, as we have seen, footnote 273, pages 373, 377, it may mimic the intensity of reality, or at any rate produce reality's motor effects. It is impossible to read Wundt's and Exner's pages of description and not to interpret the apperception and Spannung and other terms as equivalents of imagination. With Wundt, in particular, the word apperception, which he sets great store by, is quite interchangeable with both imagination and attention. All three are names for the excitement from within of ideational brain centers, for which Mr. Lewis's name of preperception seems the best possible designation. Where the impression to be caught is very weak, the way not to miss it is to sharpen our attention for it by preliminary contact with it in a stronger form. If we wish to begin to observe overtones, it is advisable, just before the sound which is to be analyzed, to sound very softly the note of which we are in search. The piano and harmonium are well fitted for this use, as both give overtones that are strong. Strike upon the piano first the G, then, when its vibrations have objectively erased. Strike powerfully the note C, in whose sound G is the third overtone, and keep your attention steadily bent upon the pitch of the just heard G, you will now hear this tone sounding in the midst of the C. If you place the resonator which corresponds to a certain overtone, for example G, of the sound C, against your ear, and then make the note C sound, you will hear G, much strengthened by the resonator. This strengthening by the resonator can be used to make the naked ear attentive to the sound which it is to catch. For when the resonator is gradually removed, the G grows weaker, but the attention, once directed to it, holds it now more easily fast, and the observer hears the tone G, now in the natural unaltered sound of the note with his unaided ear. Wundt, commenting on experiences of this sort, says that on carefully observing, one will always find that one tries first to recall the image in memory of the tone to be heard, and that then one hears it in the total sound. The same thing is to be noticed in weak or fugitive visual impressions. Illuminate a drawing by electric sparks separated by considerable intervals, and after the first, and often after the second and third spark, hardly anything will be recognized. But the confused image is held fast in memory, each successive illumination completes it, and so at last we attain to a clearer perception. The primary motive to this inward activity proceeds usually from the outer impression itself. We hear a sound in which, from certain associations, we suspect a certain overtone, the next thing is to recall the overtone in memory, and finally we catch it in the sound we hear. Or perhaps we see some mineral substance we have met before, the impression awakens the memory image, which again more or less completely melts with the impression itself. In this way, every idea takes a certain time to penetrate to the focus of consciousness. And during this time we always find in ourselves the peculiar feeling of attention. The phenomena show that an adaptation of attention to the impression takes place. The surprise which unexpected impressions give us is due essentially to the fact that our attention, at the moment when the impression occurs, is not accommodated for it. The accommodation itself is of the double sort, relating as it does to the intensity as well as to the quality of the stimulus. Different qualities of impression require disparate adaptations. And we remark that our feeling of the strain of our inward attentiveness increases with every increase in the strength of the impressions on whose perception we are intent. The natural way of conceiving all this is under the symbolic form of a brain cell played upon from two directions. Whilst the object excites it from without, other brain cells, or perhaps spiritual forces, arouse it from within. The latter influence is the adaptation of the attention. The plenary energy of the brain cell demands the cooperation of both factors, not when merely present, but when both present and attended to, is the object fully perceived. A few additional experiences will now be perfectly clear. Helmholtz, for instance, adds this observation to the passage we quoted a while ago concerning the stereoscopic pictures lit by the electric spark. These experiments, he says, are interesting as regards the part which attention plays in the matter of double images. For in pictures so simple that it is relatively difficult for me to see them double, I can succeed in seeing them double, even when the illumination is only instantaneous, the moment I strive to imagine in a lively way how they ought then to look. The influence of attention is here pure, for all eye movements are shut out. In another place the same writer says, "When I have before my eyes a pair of stereoscopic drawings which are hard to combine, it is difficult to bring the lines and points that correspond, to cover each other, and with every little motion of the eyes they glide apart. But if I chance to gain a lively mental image, Anschauung's Bild, of the represented solid form, a thing that often occurs by lucky chance, I then move my two eyes with perfect certainty over the figure without the picture separating again." Again, writing of retinal rivalry, Helmholtz says, "It is not a trial of strength between two sensations, but depends on our fixing or failing to fix the attention. Indeed, there is scarcely any phenomenon so well fitted for the study of the causes which are capable of determining the attention. It is not enough to form the conscious intention of seeing first with one eye and then with the other, we must form as clear a notion as possible of what we expect to see. Then it will actually appear." In figures 37 and 38, where the result is ambiguous, we can make the change from one apparent form to the other by imagining strongly in advance the form we wish to see. Similarly, in those puzzles where certain lines in a picture form by their combination an object that has no connection with what the picture ostensibly represents, or indeed in every case where an object is inconspicuous and hard to discern from the background, we may not be able to see it for a long time, but, having once seen it, we can attend to it again whenever we like, on account of the mental duplicate of it which our imagination now bears. In the meaningless French words, pas de l'ouron qu'a nous, who can recognize immediately the English, paddle your own canoe? But who that has once noticed the identity can fail to have it arrest his attention again? When watching for the distant clock to strike, our mind is so filled with its image that at every moment we think we hear the longed-for or dreaded sound. So of an awaited footstep. Every stir in the wood is for the hunter his game, for the fugitive his pursuers. Every bonnet in the street is momentarily taken by the lover to enshroud the head of his idol. The image in the mind is the attention, the preperception, as Mr. Lewis calls it, is half of the perception of the look-for thing. It is for this reason that men have no eyes but for those aspects of things which they have already been taught to discern. Any one of us can notice a phenomenon after it has once been pointed out, which not one in 10,000 could ever have discovered for himself. Even in poetry and the arts, someone has to come and tell us what aspects we may single out, and what effects we may admire, before our aesthetic nature can dilate to its full extent and never with the wrong emotion. In kindergarten instruction, one of the exercises is to make the children see how many features they can point out in such an object as a flower or a stuffed bird,